Okay, so you're all very, very welcome to Shannon College panel discussion, where we have students here live to tell you all about their experiences in Shannon as current students. And then we have some of our alumni who've also joined us. So I will introduce you to everyone we have here today. So firstly, we have Maeve MacDonald and Tamanna Thacker, who are both third year students in Shannon College at the moment. We also have Lewis Quinn, who is an Shannon alumni. He is joining us today from the Maldives, which he will explain. But his role is Director of Sales in the Ritz-Carlton in Singapore. That's his usual role, but he'll explain that to you. And we have Shane Ryan, who is the founder and owner of the food company Feed. And he'll tell you all about that as well throughout this session. So firstly, I suppose if anyone has any questions, we would love for you to pop them into the chat and we will get to them throughout the conversation. And if anyone wants to actually ask a question live, please feel free to put up your hand as well. We'd be happy to take them that way as well. So let's start. I suppose the first thing that I really would like to ask you guys is, you know, all those years ago, why was it Shannon? Why did you decide that Shannon was going to be the place you went to study? And I might go firstly to Shane for that one. If you'd like to maybe just tell us a little bit about where that decision came from and why you decided that Shannon was the right option for you.
Yeah, I have an aunt and uncle who are also alumni. And I wanted to follow in their footsteps, to be honest. They lived an amazing life, worked really hard, but and lived all over the world. And I said, that sounds great. And also, and I still agree with this, I truly believe that a degree in hospitality and business was a passport to the world. And I think, like, Lewis will definitely attest to this, and it was absolutely my case. It gave me access to so many different countries and a life that I don't think I could have gotten if I hadn't chosen that path. So that was really it for me. And also, I obviously did a lot of part-time jobs in hospitality since I was 16, and I just loved the industry. So I thought, you know what, I've always been quite business minded, and it was married with a real interest in hospitality and creating experiences. So for me, it was the perfect blend. So that was why I went down the path.
Absolutely. And so tell us, how many countries has it given you the opportunity to work in?
I've worked in eight.
Wow.
I worked in eight countries. Yeah. So my most recent role was in Abu Dhabi in the Middle East, and then before that I was in China. There are the last 2 years in the industry for me.
Wow. Okay. So definitely, I think I would agree that definitely a passport to the world. Lewis, how did the journey start for you? What was it about Shannon, or where did the idea to study in Shannon come from for you?
Well, similarly to Shane, my eldest brother, he studied in Shannon, and my first vacation when I was 6 years old was to go visit him in Boston, and he was working at the Ritz-Carlton there. And I just remember he was, I think, the front office manager at that time. And I was like, wow, my older brother's so cool. He's like running this whole show here, and it was such a cool property, quite an iconic property for the brand at that time. And then in transition year, you know, we have to do these kind of mini businesses. I think, I don't know if they still do that.
They do, Lewis. We're not that far out of school. They do.
Yeah, back in the Stone Age. So I set up this little shop outside the bathroom, and it was supposed to just be for 2 weeks, selling like scones and stuff. And it was really successful. And I kept it going for the entire year, and I grew my product range, and I hired some staff. I made a fortune in half the teachers at the present college. But I guess that whole kind of food and beverage, sort of running this kind of business unit for a year, right? It kind of resonated very well with me, and that customer service and evolving it to establishing credit with each teacher and chasing them for payment when, weren't paying up in time, cutting them off and all this. So that kind of got me going. And then when I met, I think it was Helena who came to the Crescent, and she just sold it. And my brother go through it as well, you know, it just resonated. And, you know, it was one of the greatest decisions I've ever made, you know, until today. My wife, I met my wife through Shannon College, and my best friends. And similarly to Shane, I've been on this journey, and you know, here I am feeling very lucky and blessed to be in the Maldives.
Yeah, we're definitely going to come back to that and ask how all of that came about. But before we do, I might ask Maeve as well where I suppose it came for her, where the interest came from.
Yeah, so I was in sixth year when I found out about Shannon College. So I was a little bit late, and I worried that I wouldn't get the interview on time. But I've also always had like a passion for food and beverage, because I have a little cake business that I started in fourth year as my fourth year business as well. So I always knew I wanted to go into something like that. But then at the same time, I wanted to do business, because I knew that to have any business, you needed the business subject or whatever. So a cousin of mine was in Shannon College, and he told me, this is the perfect course for you. You have to do it. And all I could think of was the hospitality side. And I said, well, I don't know if that's exactly what I want. And then he said, no, the business side of it is great, and you get a business degree. And then, so that's kind of what sold me, and especially the traveling as well. I love to travel. So yeah, that's why I kind of chose Shannon College.
And then Tamanna, your journey must have been a little bit different. So Tamanna's joining us today from Mumbai. So I suppose you had an even bigger decision to make. Not only did you decide Shannon College was, the choice for you, but you also had to kind of battle with the fact that you were going to move to the other side of the world to start this course. So how did that come about for you?
So I think I was in my 12th grade when I decided I wanted to do hospitality, but there's like a few challenges. The first thing was I decided that I wanted to move abroad and do something out of my comfort zone. That's when I did a little bit of research and I found about Shannon College in Ireland. And I really liked the college because it offers a degree which has a good balance between practical and theory. So whatever you learn in class, you get the chance to put it into real life when you go on your work placements. And that's why I chose to study at Shannon College.
Yeah, absolutely. I think anyone, I know personally, I'm always so impressed with our international students when they make that decision to go to the complete other side of the world at 18 years of age to go and study somewhere else. I think it's an amazing achievement, and it's a really brave decision to make. So I'm glad that you're still happy with that decision, Tamanna. So I think I might go back to Lewis now, because I think everyone will be wanting to know a little bit more about these palm trees that are behind you. And a little bit about why, you know, the director of sales for the Ritz-Carlton Singapore is definitely not in Singapore at the moment. So, Lewis, do you want to start maybe by telling us, talk us through a little bit about your career and where you started, where you were on placement and where your kind of career journey has gone since then, and how that eventually has made you now sit in front of those palm trees and make us all very, very jealous.
Sure, yeah. So my second year placement was in Geneva, and that was at the President Wilson, which I think was quite a kind of one of those iconic placement hotels for a lot of students years. And that was great. That was a food and beverage placement. I went in my first day, and the next day I remember my manager said, "Demain matin, 5h30," and I thought it was 7:30. And I was like, yeah, okay. And then she's like, sank. I was like, sank. I was like, five? Wow. So I started doing breakfast, and then I moved on to the bar, and that's where I really kind of fell in love with that kind of whole F&B scene. They had this whole great concept where they would mix flowers and perfumes with their cocktails, which was quite cool for that time. And then I went to a fine dining Lebanese restaurant, which was great to see that sort of Middle Eastern cuisine, which I hadn't never been really been exposed to. And then they asked me to stay for an additional month, for like a 13th month, to open the renovated lounge. So I had kind of a taste of, you know, opening new restaurants from that kind of young age, and to be whole part of that and to see the mistakes that were made and what went well. And then for my fourth year placement, I went to Baltimore in Maryland, and I worked for a Marriott hotel there. Big, large, 750 rooms, 90,000 square feet of meeting space. And that was a great experience. Like, I started in stewarding, and I was like, whoa, hey, I I just graduated. What's going on? But, you know, looking back right now, it was the best thing. What, you know, what it gave me was a determination. You know, first of all, I was like, I'm getting, you know, I'm moving on. I have to get myself promoted, you know, and get onto the floor or whatever I need to do. But what it has given me now is a lot of humility and a lot of understanding about how things work, you know, and it even goes to now where I'm in a position where kind of housekeeping is under my umbrella tightly now. And you think about a lot of different things and processes before making decisions that could affect a lot of different people. And that was a great year, very just fully focused on banqueting, but they approached everything, you know, it was such a large convention space, but it was all done with military precision. So everything was done, you know, the same all the time, you know, with such great consistency. Even when it came down to staffing, to setting a table, to setting a coffee break, no matter what, it was consistent and good. Okay, fair enough. Maybe a little, not so much room for creativity, but I think what with that scale, you can't afford to go off, you know, the beaten track too much. I was lucky to be able to stay for another year, actually, on a second J1 visa, where I had the opportunity to kind of go all the way up to a senior captain, which was kind of overseeing what you would call a banquet manager running events. And just in terms of leadership, organization, and staff engagement, you know, we had a lot of accomplishments during that time where we were able to like raise the needle for the engagement of staff, but from a very genuine point of view, you know, where people were kind of genuinely in better positions. They had more balanced hours. They had a better work-life balance. And then I was very, very lucky to move to Singapore. So the magic thing about hospitality, again, is this where this passport comes and the people that you meet and how it can affect your life in just such strange ways. So Singapore had sort of reduced, had made it more difficult to hire foreign labor, obviously in an effort to ensure that there was more jobs for citizens. And it was just around the time that I had been applying that that needle had shifted like 5%. So it was very, very difficult. And I was just hitting walls, you know, I was applying and I wasn't getting anywhere. And because of this, you know, regardless of my resume, of what we had achieved, I was kind of going for the perfect kind of role. If anything, it was kind of a step down, if I'm to be honest. And I just couldn't understand why I couldn't get it. And I was reaching out to the GM, the director of HR, everybody. But I was sharing it with my general manager at the time. And he's like, you want to go to Singapore? Let me call Jim. And I'm like, who's Jim? And Jim was the vice president of HR for Asia Pacific for Marriott International. I was like, oh, that's helpful. And Jim and GM Ed were housemen 40 years ago setting up banquet rooms. So they were great buddies. And he called Jim. And then, you know, then the HR comes back to me like, oh, Lewis, I think we have a slot. Let's do an interview. Here we go. But I think a good lesson about that, what I learned was like, you know, people say never say no. You know, never say no. You know, I beat every door and I wasn't taking no for an answer. And even Jim had come back to Ed and said, look, it's pretty tight. You know, they're in a difficult situation. And, you know, Sarah was my wife now, was my girlfriend at the time, was already there. And I was like, look, Ed, this is my situation. I just want to go there. And he's like, okay, I'll call him again. So I think that key learning point about relationships that you have, how important they are, and when you touched, you know, we'll speak later about kind of how alumni work. It's very similar to that situation, right? So I came into Singapore then, joined the Ritz-Carlton. That was, I think, 8.5 years ago now. And, you know, what a great, great eye-opening experience. First time in Asia. Singapore is an easy place to come into. I think a very different journey than Shane went on. You know, Singapore, when the first language is English. You know, it's a smaller country. And It was kind of easy enough to fit in. Definitely some cultural differences, but it was just such a great learning experience. After 7 months in banqueting, I joined the lounge and bar. So back to where I'd kind of touched on when I was in Geneva, and that was my first department head's role. So that whole area of accountability kind of came into play for, you know, revenue performance, profit performance, engagement of the ladies and gentlemen, and engagement, of course, our guests. Then a really exciting time in my life came when they were renovating the all-day dining restaurant. And Tony Chi, who's quite a well-renowned hotel designer, he's done a lot of properties such as, you know, Park Hyatt Tokyo and a few very famous ones. he was doing this project, and we were also doing the Chinese restaurant. So it was about a $21 million project, which in a lot of countries you can build a hotel, if not a small town with, but this was just for two restaurants. And Tony is just, I spent probably 4 weeks with Tony one-on-one, and I learned what I could learn to 6 years at school, you know, his thought process, his excitement, just lighting, music, ambience, how he would change things, and everything was really, really interesting. And we had this big all-day dining that was like a soccer field before. So if it was a quiet night, you know, you'd feel so exposed, but he transformed the space with sliding mirrored doors. The lighting goes down at around 9 o'clock. So it gets very, very intimate, though it becomes very romantic. And these are all things that are set in stone that can't change. So that was really, really great for me. From that point on, then, you know, Colony became, that was the name of the restaurant, you know, one of the most successful restaurants in the world out of the company in terms of revenue performance. So that was, you know, just a really great moment for me at that time. And I got to become an assistant director of food and beverage, and then a director of food and beverage. And oversaw different projects like renovating of the pool and pool bar. The spa kind of came a little bit under us as well, because there was a beverage concept there as well. So really sort of a very exciting dynamic time. You know, Singapore has Formula One every year, which is at such an exciting time in the calendar, where we do 80% of the catering for the paddock club. We do a big nightclub in the hotel as well. So you can imagine it's all guns blazing. All the drivers are staying with us. You know, it's such a fun week. And you know, festive is a big thing. We would do major conferences where, you know, Barack Obama was in one day, Tony Blair or whatever political figures would be in, you know, Rita Ora was singing there one day. So a really great, dynamic, ever-changing pace, which is hard to believe how 8 years went by so fast. And then an opportunity came to go to Hong Kong, but it was outside of the company, and it was with Shangri-La, and they put a very healthy offer together is kind of an executive committee food and beverage role. And it was a very open conversation, you know, with my GM. And, you know, it's something that, you know, he couldn't really say no to, because it was Hong Kong, it was a new city. Although they didn't want me to leave the brand, it's, you know, sometimes it's good to kind of step out and then step back in. And myself and my wife were kind of almost starting to pack when he was just threw this sales role at me from the side, which caught me by surprise. I wasn't expecting it at all. And, you know, the kind of rationale was that, you know, because I guess I'd performed well in driving revenue and that whole kind of creativity and kind of creating events in different food and beverage areas, they thought kind of to focus in sales, particularly for MICE, you know, meetings and events, would be a good fit. And with the ever-changing industry that we're in, particularly in luxury, is as competitive as it's ever going to be. And you know what? It's getting even more competitive. You know, in terms of luxury brands, it's gone from the select few in a city now. And if you take a city like, you know, Tokyo, Paris, you have everything from Mandarin Oriental to Peninsula to the Shangri-La's, Ritz-Carlton's, the Ritz. You've got boutique then brands, you know, like Edition and Bulgari. And they're all offering such unique experiences and getting more bespoke and becoming more refined. And the market is just incredibly competitive. And it's especially somewhere like Singapore, which carries all of those brands with a large room count. So, you know, I took it, and it was one of the hardest things I did for the first 6 months. I had no idea what I was doing. And I struggled because I was coming from a place where I was very confident. I knew what was coming, who, what, when, where, how, to not having answers when people would ask me. And of course, having a team of people who were like, who's this dude? You know, he's F&B. Now he's telling us, he's beating us. Like, what's this? And it was a different mindset. You know, the success of a sales team is because, you know, we're individual contributors. We care about our performance, my incentive. And that's good. They should think like that, because that makes them more aggressive, right? To drive, you know, more sales for the hotel. Whereas in operations, it's very different. It's kind of all together, all for one, one for all. And that's how you're able to kind of execute on a daily basis. So just learning about, you know, the comp set, you know, talking about RevPAR index and the impact that, you know, my team had both on the current year and the future years, and how we would tailor make our year to kind of reach that ultimate goal. you know, driving group business, being the bread, and then all of that retail, wholesale, you know, that higher rate being the toppings of that nice sandwich. It's kind of how I think about it in my head. So, you know, once I got into it, and then it just started to flow. And then I think the team started to see how we would get more creative, and they were very receptive of my ideas. So when we had Volkswagen in for site inspection, you know, super competitive site inspection, you know, I challenged the girls on what they had done, that it wasn't good enough. And I said, you know, we have got to get more. I said, get a car. I said, get a car and bring it into the hotel. And they did. They got an old Volkswagen combi, and we served ice cream out of it to all the kids that were there in the lobby. And this wasn't confirmed, but then we showed the guests what we can do, the clients, and we were like, look at what your brand is doing. Look how engaged everybody is. And we, you know, we contracted the next day. So we started to get very, very creative with our site inspections, very, very competitive, because, you know, they would go to all the different brands, and it became, you know, so key about that relationship building. Yeah. And the world became small. I'm probably going way over time. Anyway,
I know. I'm saying, Lewis, will we ever get to the Maldives? I'm not.
Oh yeah, sorry. COVID happened. Then, you know, it was, you know, so I had the best year. We had the best year, and then we had the worst year. But I learned more in the worst year, you know, about protecting the property, fighting for deposit, negotiation. Like, I was, and lucky, obviously, that we had great owners to support all of our team. So no one in the hotel was let go, thankfully. So anyway, why am I here now in the Maldives? So we're opening Ritz-Carlton here on June 1st. And the resort manager or hotel manager, she is giving birth on June 1st. So she's back in Europe, and she's going to give birth to a lovely baby girl. And the area vice president, I had just met her like back in March, casually. We just had a quick catch up, and I told her about a virtual site inspection that we were doing, that we had just done. And we had people come up on those little motorbikes, you know, with the little cabin on the side, to show these different activities we could do for the client, you know, because this is for 2 years' time. And, you know, we had some of our team dress up in bathrobes coming out of the spa, just telling them how good it was. So it was a really fun site, all done virtually. And it was the next week she called up and said, hey, I think you'd be great for this. And part of my development, obviously, you know, now it's kind of come full circle in the sales role. I got that down. And, you know, obviously, you don't want to be a GM soon enough. So this was kind of her helping me set that up. And yeah, I got here. I did quarantine for 12 days. I've been out for about a week. And it's kind of all hitting the ground running. You know, we have 2 weeks to kind of get the hotel ready, and or the resort, I should say. And but that's how
it doesn't look like too bad a place. No, for for that. I mean, we're all looking.
We all
thought it was just a screen, you know, one of those fake virtual backgrounds that you had there. So a little bit jealous of that. No, it's great to hear like the amazing journey you've gone through and all the different roles that you've had, and you know how it kind of does come back around. And I want to move over to Shane now, and I wanted to ask him, because I suppose Shane, you had a kind of a different journey. Obviously you did spend time in Asia as well, and you worked in hotels, but then at a point you decided that you wanted to go and do something a little bit different. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
Are you sure you want to move on? Because I'm so invested in Lewis's story. I think it's so fascinating. And I'm totally transported onto the beach.
Well, we only have 45 minutes. So, you know.
Okay. Well, I'll take 5 minutes and we'll go back to Lewis.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you could probably tell that I'm significantly younger than Lewis. So I graduated in 2013. I did my second year placement in Germany, and I remember being devastated that I didn't get a placement in Switzerland because that's where all my friends were going, but I spoke German. So I was sent to Nuremberg, but I went to an amazing, like, Grand Dame property in the middle of the city, at Le Meridien. And I did very similar to Lewis. Actually, I did an F&B internship, and I was in the kitchen for the first 6 months, and every single day I had the 4 a.m. Breakfast shift cooking eggs. Amazing, a really, really amazing experience. I really loved it. After the year there, I was finishing up, I think, in May, and I really didn't want to go home. I felt, you know, I was very much on the career track. So I was thinking, what can I do to enrich my CV and make my CV stand out? versus other people that were applying for jobs in the future once I graduated. So I actually got in touch with the college. I think it was Kate O'Connell who connected me with another graduate, an alumni, who was the hotel manager of an incredible historical property in Malta called the Phoenicia. So I went directly from Germany to Malta. I did 4 months there, working F&B as well across all the different departments, and living in paradise. It was absolutely fantastic. And then I, for my fourth year placement, my final placement, it was the year of the Olympics. So all of my friends and my peers in my year were going to London. Not all of them, a huge number of people were going to London for the Olympics. A really exciting year to be in the city. There's so much happening, particularly in hospitality. So it was a great opportunity, but I kind of felt that for me at that point in my life, London was a little bit too close to home. And so if Deborah Hammond's on the call there, she'll probably remember I was quite stubborn about the opportunities that were coming my way. I wasn't interested in London. I wasn't interested in the UK. And I wanted as far away as possible. I said, this is an opportunity to get as far away as possible and to just discover more. I think that's one of the great things about the industry is that you're not really confined to any geographical location or market. You can go anywhere. And an interview landed for an F&B, actually a rooms internship with Starwood again, with Westin in Beijing. And I said, Deborah, you've knocked it out of the park. This is exactly what I want. And I was so nervous because I was so invested. I really wanted this role. And I got it and I flew straight to Beijing. And I had an incredible year in rooms there. Realized that F&B is for me. I love F&B more than the room side. A very challenging year. I mean, I don't think I got out of it what I intended to get out of it in terms of professional development, but I learned so much personally about myself, dealing with people culturally, and I also made some of my best friends in that scenario, people from all over the world. And I think that's one of the other amazing things about hospitality, particularly when you go and do those international internships and you meet lots of other students of hospitality from other countries and you form amazing bonds. And I think that was an incredible experience for me. From there, I wasn't ready to come back to Europe actually. So I was looking around for opportunities and I remember actually, I think Lewis is maybe around the time that you were moving to Singapore, you had been there for a year or two, because I remember wanting to go to Singapore, but not being able to go because of the restrictions they just put in place. And there was a number of us actually trying to get in and we couldn't. And then I found a role with another Starwood property. So I'm like pure Starwood trained, but this was St. Regis and it was a pre-opening. So like for pre-opening is like the holy grail of opportunities for hospitality students, because you get to go into a property and have direct input into how things begin and start and put processes and systems in place and train people and really get in from the very, very beginning. And I ended up getting the job. I got an assistant restaurant manager role in an Italian restaurant called Villa Toscana in the St. Regis Abu Dhabi, which is this like monument to marble and glass right on the seafront in the middle of Abu Dhabi. This incredible property. They spent way too much money on it, but it was stunning. And I was just so excited about getting stuck into this opportunity. And I was the only non-Italian in the Italian restaurant, which was an interesting cultural experience in itself. And I was 23 and it was my first management role really. So I had a lot of responsibility. It was a real learning experience for me. And I mean, we did amazing things with that restaurant. We got to the number one restaurant in Abu Dhabi on TripAdvisor. For anyone who's familiar with, you know, the Middle East or specifically the UAE, like it's very restaurant heavy and incredibly high quality and high end hospitality experiences. That was I can't take any credit for that. It was incredible food and an incredible overall experience, but I was definitely involved in it. I was pretty proud. Then we had an opening in an all-day dining restaurant in the same property about 6 months into my role with Villa Toscana, and that was run by the late great Chef Gary Rhodes, the celebrity chef, the British chef. And, you know, it was a team of 39, and there was a restaurant manager, and I was going in as the assistant restaurant manager. And a month into that role, the restaurant manager left, and it was just me. So again, way out of my depth, but I really loved it. It was a very, very challenging time. But I suppose this is difficult because as much as I love hospitality and I love the industry, this is around the time that I started to think that maybe a long-term career in traditional hospitality wasn't for me. And so I was thinking a lot about, you know, what my next move was. And I've always been quite entrepreneurial minded. I always had intended to start something for myself. You know, for a long time, I thought that was going to be a hotel, or at least some sort of hospitality business. And I said, you know what? I have no responsibilities. I'm young enough that if it all goes wrong, I can just jump back into the industry in a traditional way. I have, you know, I'm not married. I have no kids. I have no mortgage. I have no bills. You know, now is the right time to do this. So I ended up moving back to Ireland, moved back into my childhood bedroom. And that's when my entrepreneurial career started, I suppose.
Yeah, and tell us a little bit about Feed. So what is your business?
Yeah, we're a plant-based food company. We make a range of quick cook, convenience meals, all natural ingredients. And you can find us in all supermarkets in Ireland. We're also in, actually we're in Singapore, Lewis, Singapore, Hong Kong, the UAE, and the Netherlands and the UK. So we're growing nicely. We're a team of 10 now. And every day is a new adventure in this business.
Yeah, no, and it's really exciting. And I suppose we've loved watching the progress from the college as well. And like starting off, I suppose I remember when you got your first stand. I think was it Super Value was the first.
Yeah, first customer.
Yeah, I remember that. And like now, when you walk into Super Value, you know it's pride of place right in the middle. it's great to see that. Progression. So there's a question in the chat that I'd like to just put to Lewis and Shane, if that's okay. And it's from Bill. And Bill is saying to both Shane and Lewis, how did you find the language barrier while traveling, or are you both multilingual? So Shane, do you want to go first?
I'm not multilingual. I barely speak English. I obviously would have a proficiency in German from my time in Germany. But not fluent. And China was extremely difficult. A lot of my colleagues wouldn't speak English. Like, of course they didn't need to. I did try to learn Mandarin and failed quite spectacularly. A lot of hospitality is conducted in English in my experience. So that's a real benefit. Of course, it's so advantageous to have a language. But it's absolutely not a necessity in my experience.
No, and I think particularly in China, it was something that I found very interesting the first time I traveled to China, that you know you didn't have to speak Chinese now, it really, or Mandarin, or you know, depending on where you were. But you know, like while it really would have benefited me every time I've been there, it wasn't essential. And Lewis, what about you?
Well, you know, in my spare time, I do a bit of interpreting for the United Nations, so it's
not. Oh, well, there you go.
As I said earlier, you know, I was a bit challenged at understanding that I had to start at 5:30, thinking it was 7:30 in French, so that kind of gives you a setup of my language skills. But yeah, to what Shane said, you know, English kind of is the language of hospitality around the world, and, you know, English is the first language of Singapore, so that makes it very easy. Here in Maldives, everyone speaks English. When I did an opening in Macau, you know, it's kind of mandatory almost to speak English for a lot of people. Obviously, like in stewarding, we have a lot of people who are from China who don't speak English in Singapore, for example. But, you know, what is it? 70% of the message you communicate through your body language, 20% on tone, and only 10% through words. So you can get the job done.
Yeah, absolutely. I think
it's amazing. It's amazing how you can communicate without words, actually, I find. I really utilize a lot of hand signals, particularly when I was in Asia.
Yeah, I've heard Lewis speak his few words of Mandarin, and he's very convincing anyway. I'm not how good it is, but I was impressed anyway. So I want to go over to Tamanna and Maeve, and I suppose they're as we said, they're third year students in Shannon, and they're kind of getting ready to start their career. So I'd love to know if Maeve and Tamanna have any questions that they would like to ask Lewis and Shane. So I might go to Maeve first and see, is there anything that you would like to ask of them, or anything they can help you with? Use them now wisely.
Yeah, so I just, like, from hearing both of your stories from around the world and everything, and both of you obviously started in Shannon College, how has Shannon College helped you on your journey, and are you still in contact with them?
Yeah, so Lewis, do you want to take that first?
Definitely. Like Sarah, who's on the call, we grew up together. We actually live across the street from the age zero. So organically that does. But yeah, like, I mean, I feel like the community of Shannon is something that is so, so strong. And even like myself and Shane have been lucky enough to catch up. Most of the times I come back to Ireland, unfortunately I haven't been back for a little while now, but and we're not from the same year or whatnot, and it's just that relationship is family. It really, really is. And these are people who will be there with you for the rest of your life, and you will celebrate together, you'll grieve together, you'll laugh, cry, you'll do everything, and you know that people have your back all the time, no matter how far away. And that really was evident, I would say, in the last 2 years, where, you know, we've all been distanced from each other more because, you know, with this business comes a lot of travel, so you see people quite frequently. But with that cut off, you know, in a weird way, you couldn't feel closer, you know, to the Shannon family. And it's a really special thing. I've never come across someone from a Swiss hotel school, you know, one of those fancy Swiss hotel schools, that has this relationship with their peers or their colleagues so far on, you know. Like, I mean, we graduated in the Stone Age, you know, such a long time ago, but
how dare you.
Close with my Shannon family. And the Shannon family is a term, it's not used loosely, it really is. And indeed, yes, you know, during the pandemic, Tracy was great to put the alumni together. We started to share ideas, and again, just becoming closer more so than ever. And I think hopefully as I progress in my own career, I think I'll hopefully leverage on the college more. I would love to be in a position where, you know, I can actively recruit, you know, fresh graduates, because I definitely would want to create an experience that, you know, maybe mine wasn't perfect, and I'm lucky to be where I am, but what could I do to help, you know, younger graduates, you know, and form that kind of thing, whether it's a 1 year gig or 2 year, who knows, right? And give them the different parts of exposure that I think would help. And yeah, even I use a phrase of Tracy Hegarty's to my team all the time. In revenue management, she would always compare a hotel room and an item of clothing. The item of clothing in a retail store will be there the next day, but that room that's left unsold can never be sold again. So if we lose business, I bring in the Tracy Hegarty quote, and it really hurts to the core, you know. Then they go and scrabble and try and find something else. So
Lewis, I'm afraid Tracy has just written into the chat here, and she said that there's a copyright on that. So she'll be contacting you, don't worry. So I might ask Tamanna, do you have a question that you would like to ask? Oh, you're on mute there, Tamanna.
Sorry about that. So my question was to Shane, and I think he kind of answered my question in his talk, but I just wanted to ask him, how was his experience from being an employee to becoming an employer?
It was a challenge, I think. There's a lot of synergy between hospitality and running a business, I think. And I think, you know, while I haven't chosen or followed the traditional hospitality path like Lewis and some of my friends have done, I think what I learned through Shannon and my career in hotels is absolutely applicable to how I run a business. I think, you know, businesses like hospitality are all about people. It's all about experiences. It's selling. That's everything that I learned in hospitality, as well as grasp and resilience. Like working in stewarding and working 16-hour shifts in events on an internship on 3 hours sleep, which is sometimes necessary. Like, that'll teach you the value of hard work and what's required to get stuff done. And that is absolutely what I've taken forward into the business. And I will always recommend to people, you know, an education rooted in hospitality will take you so far. And it's not just applicable to a straight hospitality career. And I think that's evident, particularly like in my class and my group of friends. Like, there's not a huge amount of us still in traditional hospitality, but we all have taken what we've learned and applied it to lots and lots of different industries to great success. So that transition from working for someone to working for myself, very, very difficult, but I definitely fell back on a lot of things that I've learned and they've carried me here.
Yeah, and absolutely. I suppose something that I take from that as well is, you know, a lot of people in my role, they'll ask me, you know, why would I go work in hotels? Because, you know, all they've heard about is those long shifts and those long hours and those unsociable hours. But I mean, something that I always bring up is, you know, all the perks that are there. And there are so many perks to the industry as well. And also, it's not every day that you're going to be doing these long hours. You know, it's when things are really busy, like as Lewis mentioned, when it's Formula One. And I mean, when it's Formula One in Singapore and you work in a hotel, you want to be there. You want to be involved. And I think that's something that's really evident in this industry. If you love it, you know, you want to be a part of all of those exciting days.
And so, like, every industry requires that level of dedication and work. Like, I truly believe if you want to be successful, you're going to need to put in the hours and the graft to get ahead. And like, yeah, I moved from a role that was 6 days a week and sometimes up to 16 hours a day. Like, that was just my personal experience in my last role. I do similar hours now. Like, I still work every single Saturday. I still work 6 days a week. I still work from 8 to 8 or 8 to 10. You know, it's if you want to get ahead, that's a requirement. So
yeah, I agree.
Just to jump on that, I hate that kind of stigma and that conversation, because there's definitely people out there who, you know, I call them dinosaurs, who insist that everybody works 15 hours a day or whatever unnecessarily. And, you know, definitely when I first started out, I saw that and, you know, probably fell into it a little bit. And then I kind of came to a point, it's like, what am I doing? I have nothing to do. I'm done. And I guess it comes with confidence. And, you know, I even, you know, I would have had, you know, leaders who would still be working, and you're always kind of edgy. Oh, do I need to stay late? Or if they go home, if what's that like? But then I was like, you know, if you're performing in your area, and it all comes down to how you manage and that leadership, you recruit the right people, you train them well, you entrust and you give them the authority, and you give them, you give them that responsibility to run the show when you're not there. And you provided your area smooth sailing or whatever, you know, there's no need on a normal business day, right, to be staying there beyond, as long as your area is running, you run a tight ship, you know, you work a normal day. Of course, there's Formula One and there's these exciting times and there's Christmas, but that is, you know, it's a little different, right? And as Jane said, you know, you've got to put in the hours to be successful. But if anyone would ever say, you know, oh, you have to work 12 or 15 hours a day, you know, just ignore it and just try not to work, because they're just completely dated in their mindset and just gone.
It's a real legacy reputation, right? It's a real old-fashioned reputation that hospitality has. And I think actually one of the, as difficult as the last year and a half has been for hospitality, I think one of the big things that's starting to come out of it is that it has to change, and that people have started to realize that it's not sustainable anymore. So I think there's so much creativity happening in the industry right now. It's an incredibly exciting place to be as things are changing and shifting and adjusting.
And so something as well, and I know we're kind of running running over a little bit, but something that I just think I want to go back to as well is something that Lewis, you mentioned earlier, was, you know, you mentioned that you were managing the ladies and gentlemen. And like, I think when you look at hotel brands, and I'm just using Ritz-Carlton as an example, because that's who you're working for, Lewis. But, you know, there's, maybe tell us a little bit about the motto or the slogan for Ritz-Carlton. And I think that that's a really good message to take away, is that, you know, it, you know, the people are the most important part of any hospitality business. And I think that that is reflected in that slogan. So, Lewis, you might talk us through as the Ritz-Carlton ambassador on the call.
Yeah, like, I mean, it's a world-renowned phrase. And, you know, I remember when I was leaving the Marriott core brand and I was joining Ritz, you know, a lot of my colleagues were like, ooh, you're going to be a lady and a gentleman. But it is a cult. It is a cult. And it is a thing. But, you know I almost left, but I don't want to leave this brand ever. I love working for it. And even especially in this experience now, you can really feel the culture is kind of stronger than ever, right? With everything that has happened. And just to share, for example, you know, we're opening the resort. So we need the rooms to be slept in and to be tested. And typically, I think the executive committee would normally go first and get in there, right? But it's the reverse. We have the housekeeping team in, and, you know, I set this up, the housekeeping go first, engineering goes next, front of house then, and then food and beverage, the chefs, stewarding, everybody will stay before an executive committee member stays. And that's because they are the ones who are working with this product. They are the ones who are going to orientate the guests, and they deserve to know it first. And likewise, we will have kind of a recreational area for them to rest. And, you know, I was there at the GM today, we were getting it set up, you know, and we're chasing supplies for the beanbag. There's a lot of other issues. You know, we're missing chairs in the restaurants, we're missing forks, and we're there, but we'll be able to handle that. We'll manage somehow, right? We'll find a stool somewhere. But it's more important that the area for the ladies and gentlemen to rest, and, you know, we're gonna have a foosball table and all this kind of stuff, is set up, because they need that bay. We're in an island in the middle of nowhere. They need a place to be able to chill out.
Just for anyone who's on the call who might not know who you're referring to as the ladies and gentlemen, what is the actual slogan? What's the brand's
goal? Oh, yeah. So it's ladies and gentlemen serving ladies and gentlemen. So, you know, we're on an equal playing field to our guests, you know, and treat our guests the same, and we expect that to be treated the same way. And it's great. And in Singapore, it's very, very strong. You know, just even taking my career journey is relevant of that, you know, to challenge me and put me in different areas. I can make mistakes, but I'll have had, you know, they'll have my back. And I've been able, you know, as I've gone to create great journeys for my team and for my, you know, for them to grow and prosper. And just, it's always a decision making thing, you know, how this affects the team, how this affects the ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
And they're forward. And of course it depends on the leadership of the hotel. You know, and you have to live and breathe it. Singapore has a great executive committee where it's in their DNA. The GM here, he's new to the brand, but he's totally invested. And what he said was, he goes, I'm looking for this kind of company to work for, because they're saying what I've been saying all my life. And now I'm here, and we're on the same page. And yeah, it's, I couldn't say, obviously, you know, I know I'm biased, but I've seen other companies, I've had colleagues work for other companies, and there's an evidential difference, I think, in how we approach.
I think that is definitely becoming very apparent in a lot of hospitality brands. So I'm just conscious that we're actually over time. We'll be in trouble, but that's okay. And I just wanted to finish up. Firstly, I wanted to say, please make sure that you do go and check out the hotel that Lewis is there to open. So the Ritz-Carlton, the Maldives, there's some amazing photos up there of what it will look like when it opens. So do check that out. And definitely check out Shane's company as well, Feed. Very, very tasty, very handy food. So might be something for you all to be looking out for, especially, you know, you're going to be students next year. You know, you may not have as much time on your hands, and you won't have maybe somebody else there to help you with cooking. So this could be a savior for you. So I wanted to finish off by asking just the two of you, Shane and Lewis, if you have any words of advice for the people that are on the call today and Tamanna and Maeve, who are kind of getting ready to start their career in hospitality. So have you any, maybe one piece of advice that you might give to them, Shane?
I suppose I touched on it already. I think the prospect right now of entering hospitality could potentially be a little bit daunting, particularly after the struggles of the last year or so. But I actually think it's a really exciting time to be entering into that path and into that ecosystem. I think there's so many opportunities and so much change happening. It would be incredible to be a part of that. And I also think it's so important just to be open to things, to, you know, take the risk to go somewhere where not all of your friends are going, to follow the less beaten path, I suppose. And also, you know, yes, there is a traditional hospitality route, but there's so much more, there's so many more opportunities too that are open to you as a graduate of hospitality. I think that's the really special thing about Shannon.
Absolutely. Thanks, Jane. And Lewis, is there anything you'd like to say to them?
Yeah, just to echo what Shane said, you know, go as far as you can further afield, push yourself. I had a lot of anxiety taking this opportunity here, and I said no first because I was like, there's a pandemic, I have this, and all these things could happen. And actually, a lot of things have happened. I can't actually get back into Singapore as of today, but I'm okay. It's for 3 months, so I'm learning as well to be loose and to be free and to not be in control of everything all the time, because you cannot be at this time. And you're coming into an industry that is so ready for this ramp up. You know, I don't know anyone who's not thirsty or hungry to travel. A, to see their family and loved ones and friends. They've been separated for too long. B, for experiences, you know, to get out into the water, to rock climb, to whatever people want to do. So it's a very key time for hospitality, because we have to be better than ever. We have to really ensure that we're creating these experiences. It's so much more than the bed and the shower and the Wi-Fi or whatever. It's about embracing the local culture and all of that. So it's really an exciting time. Don't be daunted by how damaged the industry was. Lots of lessons were learned. Technology has come in and really transformed how we do things. Look at the different markets. Look at what's open. Look at what's, you know, where has done well and hasn't done well. Leisure will come back first. So resort areas or places where, you know, people will go for vacation and whatnot will come back first, versus a very corporate environment. We'll take a little bit more time for the corporate companies to allow their people to travel again. And, you know, just be very strong, assertive of what you want. Be competitive. Always be number one. Always win. And when you don't, learn and then get back on the horse and go again.
Well, I think that's great advice. And I certainly am one of those people who's really looking forward to international travel coming back. I think the fact that you're there now for 3 months, Lewis, maybe I'll get to the Maldives yet. We'll wait
I'll
and
be
see.
Coming with you, Sarah.
Oh, yeah. OK. We'll have to charter a plane at this rate. No, listen, firstly, I would just like to thank everyone for joining this call today. It's great to have you here, and I want to say thank you to Tamanna and Maeve for joining us and for, you know, their questions and their input. And then, of course, I would love to thank Shane and Lewis for joining and giving, you know, telling us about your journey. And I think that your insight is so, so valuable. And I hope you'll inspire lots of young hoteliers to keep going in the journey and to join the industry. So thank you so, so much. I hope we will speak again soon.